Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai, Adonai Echad. Baruch Shem Kavod Malchuto, Leolam, Leolam Vaed. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be moved, Lord. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. I shall not be from him is my expectation. My soul, wait thou only, only upon God, for from him is my expectation. My defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be moved. He is my defense, I shall not be only. He only is my rock and the horn of my salvation.
Okay, we've got the thumbs up from the booth. If everyone can take their seats, Shabbat Shalom on this cool autumn day in Rochester. I was expecting the leaves to start to change. You know, we had our week of summer now. No, of course not. So I drove in with Raphael this morning. He said, no, we haven't started summer yet. This is still like extended spring. Okay, fine. So how many people here like to take tests? Oh, stop it. Okay. So I'm gonna put in a shameless plug here for the Messianic Judaism class because you know what? There's a workbook, and there's you know, a class every week, and then there's a test at the end. We gotta hook up with Ava to figure out how to do that. But what I enjoy about the Messianic Judaism class is that you get these little insights like Rabbi produced last week about the roots, right? So how many people here have seen Indiana Jones movie X, whatever it is? Okay, Raiders of the Lost Ark. I kind of think that the Messianic Judaism class is like that, because you go there and you have these little aha moments about, yes, and Rabbi is putting on his kippah. I'm thinking he needs like one of those fedoras or whatever they call those hats, you know? Because you go there and he helps you understand the political overlay and the association of the roots, the agricultural stuff that just kind of blows by me as a person in the 20th century, right? Or 21st, I guess we are in the 21st century, right? Yes, thank you. And so that, and last week, Rabbi had this image of the redwood trees and the intertwined roots of that. And for me, at this stage of my life, I just look at the Bible as that. If you're reading the Bible and you're just reading it and it's like, oh, well, that's a nice story, it's kind of like you're missing out on it because the whole thing is woven together. So just as Rabbi talked about last week, it's like there's study, there's worship, there's praise, there's meditation, there's prayer. But I think if there's that component of, if you're not getting more than just reading words, you're not getting it. And you need to get to someone who's going to help you, who's going to teach you the interrelatedness of the entire Bible. And that's what really comes out in that class. So I think we need a marketing rebuild on that. We'll call it the MJC or something like that. But now that we have a budget for marketing, maybe we'll dress that thing up, right? Anyway, okay. So if the men would come forward for the Talit blessing. Okay, gentlemen. It's a good turnout here for Father's Day. Yes. Yep. Hand praise, yes. All right, gentlemen. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu lahitatef b'tzitzit. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to wrap ourselves in the tzitzit.
And would everyone please rise for the Matovu? The men can follow Keith and the ladies can follow me.
Ma tovu, O halecha Yaakov,
O halecha Yaakov, mishkenotecha Yisrael,
O halecha Yaakov. How lovely are your tents, O Jacob, your dwelling places, O Israel. Thank you, Lord, for this day, this crisp, wonderful morning that you've brought us here together to learn, to just be praising you, to be acknowledging you, to hear of your word, and to be spoken to by not our rabbi this morning, but we are looking forward to words of wisdom that we will take with us. Father, and I just thank you for that word that's interwoven throughout the Bible, throughout the scroll, and that you've allowed us to just explore that and understand it each day as we live. In Yeshua's mighty name we pray, amen.
So we'll just wait a moment for a few people to come join. All right, please join with me in the Shema. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem, Kevod Malchuto, Le'olam Va'ed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his name, whose glorious kingdom is forever and ever. Amen. Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levavcha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'odecha. V'hayu hadvarim ha'ele asher anochi mitzavcha hayom alevavecha. V'shinan tam levenecha v'dibarta bam b'shiftecha b'vetecha u'v'lechtecha v'aderech Uvshachbaka uvkumecha, ukshatam loot aliyadecha, vahayu lototafot bain inecha, uktavtam amuzuzot betecha uvishalecha. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. And you shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for frontlets between your eyes. And you shall write them upon the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Ve'ahavta l're'echa kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. And now we can thank our Father for sending Yeshua, our Messiah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu et derech ha-Yeshua b'mashiach Yeshua. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Feels like it's been a little while since we've done the Vishamru. We've had so many holidays and special occasions coming up. So today, the special occasion is the one that happens once a week, Shabbat, where you get to take that rest. So please join with me in the Vishamru. V'shamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'dorotam berit olam. B'nei uvein, b'nei Yisrael, oti le'olam, oti le'olam. V'shamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'dorotam berit olam. Ki sheshet yamim asah Adonai et ha-Shamayim ve'et ha'aretz. V'shamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'dorotam berit olam. Uv'ayom ha-Shvi Shavuot v'inefash, Shavuot v'inefash, Shavuot v'inefash. V'shamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'dorotam berit olam. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Amen. And now please join with me in the Adonai Sifatai. And because this is a little different, we have a lot more new people here today, I'll explain a little bit. I'm going to face the Ark. You are already facing the Ark. That's this cabinet here, and that contains the scroll of the Torah. And in this case, it's kind of a stand-in for God's throne, not literal, but figurative. And we, when we face it, we begin with three steps back to show your humility before God's throne. And then when we do the English, you can do three steps forward, if you choose, to show that we can also boldly approach that throne. Adonai Sifatai Tiftach Ufi Agita Hilatecha. Adonai Sifatai Tiftach Ufi Agita Hilatecha. Adonai, open up my lips that my mouth may declare your praise. Amen.
Amen. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God, that we can boldly come before you today, that we can worship you openly. Oh, Lord, we want to thank you for this day. We want to thank you for healing in our families. We want to thank you for healing that is yet to come, even right now in this place, for people who are going to be healed and who are being healed right now. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we are excited to worship you today. Hallelujah.
Yourself up on a high mountain, O Zion, bearer of good news, and lift up your voices mightily, Jerusalem, bearer of good news. Lift them up, do not fear. Lift them up, do not fear, and say to the cities of Judah, do not fear, lift them up, do not fear, and say to the city of Judah, your God is here. The deliverance of the Lord, your God is here.
Right here.
The saving grace of the Lord, your God. Lift them up, do not fear. Lift them up, do not fear, and say to the city of Judah, your God is here.
Your God is here.
Your God is here.
Hey! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah. How many people believe that God is here right now? Amen. God is right here. And if he seems far away, guess who moved? I didn't write that one, but it's true. If he seems far away, you probably moved away because he's right here.
Come closer. Come closer.
Awake, awake, Zion. Timing, that there is a time and a place for everything. Amen? Amen. So, oh daughters of Zion, oh Abraham's sons, hear the words of your father. Hear his promise of love. Oh, wonderful, wonderful promises. And the Bible is full of promises. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, daughters of Zion, oh, Abraham's sons, hear the words of your father, hear his promise of love. I will make you a blessing, count the stars if you can. You will be a great nation, I will give you this land. Back home, bring
ends of the earth. I will send you a Savior. I will finish my work. You have no other shepherd. You have no other Lord. Green pastures are waiting in Zion once more. For the peace, but look to the east, for the sun rises sudden and fierce. Every prophet and priest and king in the city will look on the one they have pierced. We will mourn for the one we have pierced. But don't fear, O my daughters, or sons of Abraham. I will wash you with water. I will offer the lamb. Though your sins were like scarlet, they'll be whiter than snow. I have always been with you. I will never let go. I will bring you back home. Bring you back home, oh my children. You will no longer roam, lost and that never go out of style. Thank you, Lord, that a song that we sang over 20 years ago could still be important and relevant today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Abba, Father, lay your hands on me. Holy precious Father, how
Into love, love, love.
perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Oh, it's love.
Thank you, Father. Thank you that you are a good, good Father. Thank you, Lord, that you are the example of a good Father to all of us. Thank you, Father, for making us your children, men, women, Jew, Gentile, little ones, older ones. We are all your children. We are thankful that you have brought us into your family. You have made us part of the family of God. We're just so thankful today. Thank you, Lord. Let's just say thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you for being a father. Thank you for being a good father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Diane has a motherly word, I think.
Shabbat shalom. The Lord would say to you today that, yes, he's a good, good father, and he loves you very, very much, and he died for you. He died to make you his child. That's a lot to go through, just to be a child. Birth is bad enough, but we didn't die having our children. But he died having you. But he wants to know that he's also a good father because he controls us in our badness. He helps us to overcome the things that are not godly. He gives us strength. He gives us mercy. He gives us guidance. He gives us all the things we need to walk in a holy manner before him, and he asks that you would listen. Listen to the still small voice in your head. Listen to your conscience. God will guide you wherever you are. He will take you whatever you've done. He will heal you. He will bless you, and he will forgive you. Just believe in Yeshua's name.
Father, we just pray into that word. Help us, Lord, to hear your still small voice. Sometimes we think of a father's voice as being loud and booming, and sometimes it is, but sometimes it's just the quietness and the authority of that voice. So help us to discern your voice. And even more than that, Lord, help us to obey. Your word says we're to be not just hearers, but obeyers of your Lord. Of your word. So we pray for that for all of us here. We pray for that for those who are coming in online, who are watching. May we all increase in our ability to hear the Father and to obey the Father. In Yeshua's name. In Yeshua's name. Amen. 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 Well, great to have all of you here today to be able to worship together. Shabbat Shalom to all of you. That's good. A good answer is good. And Shabbat Shalom to all of you behind the little red light back there on the camera. We're delighted that you are tuned in and that we're able to send out this to you. And we pray that if you're within driving distance, that sometime you'll come and join us and be with us right here. And we have some things that we like to give out to those who are visiting with us for the first time. So if you're here for the first time, and you didn't get a packet, which has some information in it, but also a card, which if you fill out, will get you on our email list, and you'll be made aware of all the things that we're doing. Raise your hand right now if you didn't get one. Anybody here for the first time and didn't get a packet like Ruth is holding up back there? Okay, so if you got one of those, Don over here collects them at the end of the service. If you fill it out, they'll get you on our email list. And also, Keith did a great infomercial for me for the Messianic Judaism class, so I can be brief and say if you want to participate in what Keith was talking about when we started in the Messianic Judaism class, you just need to send an email to the office or to me, and I will put you on the Zoom list, and you'll get a Zoom invitation Tuesday evening, 7 o'clock to about 8:30 on Zoom. And it's open to everybody. Got about 15 people on it right now, and it's a discussion group, and we have a great time. So take that from Keith, right, Keith? So you're invited to that. And now we're going to do something a little bit different today. It's great that we ended up with that song, It's a Good, Good Father, because as most of you are aware, tomorrow is Father's Day. So we want to take a moment and honor and give a gift to the fathers here. But as usual, we don't want to leave anybody out. So I'd like to have all the men come on up here at this point, and boys, all the men and boys, because we want to give a gift to all of the physical fathers, and then to all of the spiritual fathers, and also to all of the future physical or spiritual fathers. So all the men come on up here, and the boys, and Mark's going to pray, okay? And then we're going to have some instructions for you about how to get a gift. Everybody, come on up. Yes. Physical.
We certainly want to honor the fathers, but we're going to start off with our leadership. Amen. So this is for Rabbi. Pastor Tom, where is he? He's Rabbi David, this is for you. So if you could open them, and we want to know what they say, because everyone wants to know what they say. So Rabbi David, here, you first step over here. I'm trying to get the mic away from the speaker.
Yeah, that's a good idea. All right, this one says, do not pray for easy lives. Pray to be stronger men.
Pastor Tom. It's got to be specific for each of them.
I don't have a dad bod. It's called a father figure.
You have yours, Rabbi.
Wisdom in it. It says, so when is this, quote, old enough to know better supposed to kick in?
Say it again, Rabbi.
When is this old enough to know better is supposed to kick in? Thank you.
So my wife said this one was appropriate for me, her, and Grace. 25-cent charge for whining. 25-cent for whining. So I'm going to read the scripture that we have set for the men and our men's group. Currently, I facilitate that. That's just current. We all have leaders, so we don't dub a leader, even though technically it's a leader, but facilitator. And it comes from, this is our foundational scripture for men's fellowship. It's Luke chapter 22, verses 31 and 32. The Amplified version opens it up for meaning. And it says here, Simon, Simon, Peter, listen. Satan has demanded permission to sift all of you like grain. But I have prayed especially for you, Peter, that your faith and your confidence in me, as Yeshua is talking to him, may not fail. And you, once you have turned back again to me, strengthen and support your brothers in faith. Amen. So, Father, we thank you for each and every one of these men, the biological dads, the spiritual dads, the godfathers, the bigger brothers, the uncles, the grandfathers, and the young men that are fathers to be. We thank you, Lord, for each of them. We pray especially for our leadership, Rabbi Jim, Rabbi David, Pastor Tom, the elders, and all of them represented here, Father. This is a representation of your kingdom. And we pray here in this congregation that they will fulfill their role as men and fathers and leaders of each household they represent. Lord, we ask in Yeshua's name that you anoint them with a blessing that they cannot shake off of them, that they are protected and covered under the blood of Messiah, and that you will always be the example that they have and that they can look to for what a father is and is supposed to be. We won't renege on that. We won't pull back on that. We ask you not to let it off of them. They are anointed to be the men, males, that you have intended them to be. In Yeshua's name, amen. Let's give them a big hand. Amen. So what we're going to do,
Mark,
right now.
Mark, before you do that, let's include people on the live stream, the fathers and men on the live stream.
Yes, absolutely. And I my prayer, I wrote down specifically for all of you on live stream, is that to forgive me for not making you feel more included in our prayers, and that you are so welcome, you are so appreciated. And we praise the Lord for all of you on live stream, and we include that prayer for fathers for all of you. And we ask that you come on in and visit with us when you're here locally. Amen? Amen. Okay, so what we're going to do first, we're going to ask everyone's patience. We're going to uncover. So each thing is a specific thing for how you see yourself or what may be useful for you under the table. It's a selection this year. So we're going to uncover, we're going to ask the biological fathers to pick one item themselves first. Tom, can you help me with this? I'm going to give it to you, and you can fold it up. So there are a number of things. One says, best dad in the whole house, number one dad. There's a little saute pan for grilling. There's a little grill mat for veggie grilling. It says, best dad ever is one. This one is a meat tenderizer for a steak or whatever. There's a gift card to Mission Barbecue in one. This one says here, to the world, you are just a dad, but to us, you are the world. Always remember how much we love you. And then these are some skewers, if you're going to do that, kebabin or whatever you want. And then there's just one or two of these for, guess what, Chick-fil-A. So we're going to ask the biological dads to come forward. We tried to get the numbers right and how many. And so grab one, and then we'll go from there because we want to move quickly.
What we're going to do is we're going to go to break. Okay. So live stream, go into the break mode. And the rest of you, as soon as everybody gets done here, can get up and go say hi to each other, assuming you want to be close to people, if not, just stay in your seat. But this is our traditional time when we connect with each other.
service. All right. I'm getting there. Just a few more settlers. Thank you, Mark. All right. This week on Bagels and Blessings, Ethel's guest is Gilal, or Gail Nelson Azam. She's the daughter of the late Carol and Roger Nelson, the former leaders of Beth Tefillah Messianic Congregation in South Ozone Park, Queens, New York, which gives me pause of why do you want to live someplace named Ozone, but that's okay. Apparently she did. Anyways, at the age of 10, Gilal made a profession of faith, but her real decision to follow Yeshua came when she was 19 years old. After being a stay-at-home mom for about 16 years, she now works for Nazareth Village, where they recreate what Nazareth looked like in the time of Yeshua. She is the assistant manager, does guided tours, and invites anyone coming to Israel to come and have and visit. Also, anyone who makes a purchase from the bookstore, which will be open after service today, will get a ticket to win a prize on Bagels and Blessings, so be sure to do that. Also, stop into the bookstore. They are having a special $1, $2, $3 sale, so books will be on sale for $1, $2, and $3. There's lots of really good books that have been put out, so be sure to stop in there, and once they're gone, they're gone, so it's kind of like a, you know, get in there and get it. So be sure to see Ava for more information if you need that. Our Shema Connect class is Saturday mornings at 9 a.m., and this is for anyone who is new to Shema or to the faith, and you can contact Ava for more information on that. Our Benafshi class will be Thursday, June 23rd at 7:30 p.m. via Zoom. This is for anybody who is interested in a more in-depth understanding and application of the spiritual roots of disease and difficulties, and you can contact Rabbi Jim for more information and to be included in that Zoom meeting. We will also be having our next Davidic dance class. That will be Saturday, June 25th at 9:15 a.m. in the Oneg Hall. Shea teaches one or two of the dances that we do up here that will go with the songs the worship team are doing that week. Then it's a free drop-in class for anybody over the age of 10, so be sure to come to that if you saw what we did up here and thought it looked fun and you wanted to try it, or you just want to refresh what you already know, be sure to come to that. And then we will be having a Shabbat service honoring our teachers who put a lot of time and energy into the kids and doing plans for them and activities and really helping them grow in the Lord. So that will be Saturday, June 25th in our regular Shabbat service, and you can see Judith for more information. And we will be having a Kiddush after that service, and that will be out in the Kiddush corner, and you can see Shea for more information on that. Our next women's ministry meeting is Sunday, June 26th at 11 a.m. We'll be having a licensed nutritionist and life coach coming to speak, so that should be very exciting. So please see Rebbetzin Diane for more information. And there is a clipboard going around because we are going to be here for lunch, so we're asking people to bring a dish to pass. And after that will be an afternoon of song recital. Then that will be the same date, the 26th at 3 p.m. And Shea is going to be singing. Yes, you can applaud. And her friends, and they will be singing the songs that Shea has actually got her expertise in, I guess you could say. So if you want to come hear some Italian and some French and lots of things, you can come and see that. And it's a great chance to actually hear her sing full voice. And also, if you have taken the Messianic Judaism class, but you haven't finished up and you're a little intimidated by all those tests that Keith was talking about, because there's actually five tests, not one test, but they're open book, so, you know, really, it's not that bad. But anyways, if that's a little intimidating for you, then you can come, and Ava will be helping people take their tests, and that will be on July 24th, so be sure to see her if you need more information on that. And then Rabbi David has a few words for us.
It's time for the giving. But before we do that, I do actually have one very special, very important announcement. Sorry, worship team, I didn't really work that out with you. Got your timing off. It's this. Next Shabbat, next Saturday, after service, we are going to have a special congregational meeting on some new safety protocols that we're implementing here. It's very, very important that if you can be there, that you are there. And for those of you that watch on live stream, it will not be live streamed. So if you want to know what these are, I really would encourage you to come. And then afterwards, we're going to have a Kiddush, so there'll be some food. So you can stay a little longer, and it'll be fine. It won't be long. It'll just be about 20 to 30 minutes. I'll say 20 minutes, yeah. And that way it doesn't seem as long. And again, there's some things that we want to do here, safety-wise, that are very important, and we want to help you understand what those are and why we are doing it. So again, that's next weekend after Shabbat, after the service, we'll be talking about that. So put it in your calendar. All right, now on to the giving. Yes, come on up. You know, I always like to think of something from the Word about giving as we come into this time. And I do want to say this, that we're actually, it's a double happy time because we're going to have two offerings today. All right, so we have our normal offering, yes. And then we're going to have a special offering for our guest speaker, Pat, from Ukraine, and giving into what he's doing. So be ready for that as well. And Rabbi Jim will come later to do that. But Yeshua said this, very simply. His disciples quoted him in Acts chapter 20, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." That's very easy to understand. Sometimes we complicate the word blessed, and it can have different meanings in different contexts. But there it simply means a person that gives is happier than a person that receives. It makes you happier. And that's good. We all want to be happy these days. Everybody's looking for a way to be happy. But there is a condition on that. Because you might be thinking, it'll make me very happy to give. I like it coming in, you know. It all depends on your view and your faith in God. If you believe that God is your provider, if you really believe that, love giving, it makes you happy because you know he's going to continue to provide. If you don't recognize him as your provider and it's all up to you, you want to keep as much as possible. So this morning, let's give knowing that God is our provider. And therefore, you'll be able to be more happy as you give. For those of you online, or those of you here, if you'd like to give online, you can give at www.shemaisrael.givingfire.com. Go there and donate. And so if you want to give, I know the ushers already were going around. There's got some giving envelopes. I should have done that probably sooner in this. But raise your hand. They'll give you one. And then they will come around and pass out the baskets and collect them. But now we're going to turn over to our worship team for our offertory song.
All right, and just a quick reminder, if you're here today with a cell phone, please make sure it's either on vibrate or turned off. We don't want to hear a lot of dings and whistles and things going off, especially when the speaker is up front. It can be distracting. All right, we are going to continue worshiping the Lord, so feel free to stand up and worship with us. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Psalm 133.
Hine matova manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine matova manayim shevet achim gam yachad. Hine
la 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 la
right, we are going to pray for and dismiss our children to their classes. Could the four men that are designated to carry the tallit come and grab that? And who's our fourth? All right, is everyone going to fit under here? You fit? Yeah. Yeah, you guys all fit? Great. Okay. Yisimcha Elohim k'Ephraim v'chim Menashe, yivisimech Elohim k'Sarah Rivka Rachel v'Lea. Lord, make our sons like Ephraim and Manasseh, forgetting the troubles of their past and having a fruitful future. Lord, make our daughters like Sarah and Rebecca, like Rachel and like Leah, who built the house of Israel. Lord, I pray that you would be with these children, that you would fill them with your spirit, with your strength, with zeal for your kingdom, for your word, for your truth, for knowing your character inside and out. And I pray that they would carry your light wherever they go, and that you would teach them now from your word and be with their teachers also. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Amen. Shabbat Shalom again. I have the privilege to facilitate the men's group, but I have the honor to stand before you for prayer. And so just another role in God's assignment in the kingdom. So I cherish this one as well. So it's time for us to pray. We're so honored to have everyone, even online, and all of you here to join us in prayer. And Pat, I'll be as quick as I can. It's prayer, and so we'll get you right up here very quickly. I just want to say this. The Men's Fellowship is this Wednesday, this week. I just got Kyle's information, so he's already in the men's group chat. And sorry for that, guys. I hit you up in service. But I wanted to make sure I get him in. So it'll be at Jack and Melissa's house. Wave your hand, Jack. I will get the, and wave your hand, Melissa, thank you for leaving your house for us guys to come over. And so I will get the information out to their for their address this week. It'll be a Tuesday night, and then it'll be a Wednesday day reminder that we're meeting at Jack and Melissa's to fellowship over there. And we're going to have a word from Rabbi David for Ed Men's Fellowship this week. So encourage everyone to come out for that. And so we thank you. We had a phenomenal time in pre-service prayer. You can see this is a wonderful slide that's been put together. It is absolutely stating the best. And pre-service prayer, if you haven't joined pre-service prayer, you ought to come in and just get inundated with the Spirit of the living God. It is absolutely riveting. Tears were falling this morning. And I was setting up the stuff for the men and walked in the room and just got struck by the Spirit of the living God. And it was just fascinating. Tears, joy, shouts, screams, speaking in unknown tongues, interpretation. We just were there. We're going to have miracles breaking out soon. Right, Ava? Right, Bob? We're going to have miracles in that room. So please come. One of the things that came to me, and we're going to get to prayer, is there was a word, and I could preach the message, and I know Elizabeth's going to go crazy when I give the title in such a way. But the Lord said, how can you be so big when little's got you? How can you be so big when little's got you? So we want the heavenly, high, lofty things, but we won't do the little things that God tells us to. You go to the store, you knock something off the rack, and you keep walking. But someone's seen you do that. So God saw you, then he had a witness. But we're so heavenly minded that we don't take care of the little things. How can you be so big for God when little things got you? That's just a message in itself. We won't go there. But we need to do the little things. And here, this slide right here is some of the little things. So join in that, and God will do great things in your life. Father, we thank you for this time again of Shabbat where we can rest in you. We pray, Lord, that we experience that rest today, and we exalt you and magnify you, and thank you for creating this day for us. And we are so excited about what you're going to do the rest of the service. We pray your blessing over the prayers as we release them now under this open heaven. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem and all those who are there. We're thanking you for Brandon and the team that's been there. We look forward to them returning home safely as you've kept them so far. We thank you for the borders of Israel, Lord, that you're continuing to watch over them and giving those who are in charge the wisdom to take care of the people there. Father, we lift up our U.S. economy and our supply chains. We need your hand in all of this, Lord. The way that they're having it to go, we will be out of things in a brief, short years. But we pray, Lord, there'll be an awakening in our supply chain and our economy. I pray a financial healing and wholeness over everyone under the sound of my voice. No matter what's going on in the economy, I pray, Lord, that we will be covered. Doesn't matter about inflation. You will keep our resources and our income and the things that you bless us with at a high level so we can bless your name and bless others. We thank you, Lord. And we recognize tomorrow will be June 19th. They call it Juneteenth, 1865. There was a liberation of African Americans and black people in America. 750,000 soldiers lost their lives, Lord, as you know, recorded that lost their lives. It was a fight for freedom, and it was a fight to keep enslavement called the Civil War. But Lord, we thank you that it was a breakthrough, and we're here celebrating you in this land, and we ask you continue to be with us as we go forward years and years from now, as we come together as one and not as a divided nation as we once were. Father, we lift up Dr. Simone Gold. She is the founder of America's Frontline Doctors. She was found to be in Washington January 6th, so now she has to serve a 60-day prison sentence plus fines and fees. So we lift up Dr. Gold right now, Lord. We ask that you secure her faith and that you would keep her anchored in you for all that she has to go through. And we pray, Lord, that you will certainly provide justice, not just for her, but, Lord, it will be equal justice under the law if she has to serve time. There are 9 others linked to the Stephen Colbert show that were found to be there. And so, Lord, we don't want them to slide because who they're connected with, but we want everyone to be treated fairly. Father, we're sad to pray for a Philadelphia firefighter, 27-year-old firefighter, lost his life this morning between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m. 5 people were rescued when a building collapsed, but he did not survive. And so, Lord, we pray for those who are mourning the loss of their brother as firemen and the loss of a servant for that community. We lift up first responders all over the nation, and we pray, Lord, that you will continue to give them the courage to do the work to serve mankind. And we ask, Father, that you be with them each and every step of the way. I pray, Lord, for our visitors who are watching online, those who come in. We pray for you. We ask God to bless you and to keep you. And I ask you to forgive me that even live stream, we haven't, seeming as though we haven't prayed for you enough. You are covered in all of our prayers. We praise the Lord for you. We love you. We like to have you here with us as soon as you can be. Father, and quickly coming to a close, I want to lift up my sister-in-law, Lynn, her best friend, Leah, has been battling ovarian cancer. And Lord, unfortunately, as you know, she was diagnosed with breast cancer. And so, Father, we pray for Leah and her husband and the strength that they need, the strength that Lynn has to be a dear friend to her. And we thank you for her life, that it's going to be full, even with the number of days you have left for her in this earth. We pray for Rebecca's brother, Rob, who's in Europe traveling, and we ask for your protection over him and cover him as he's doing his business as a chef. And Father, we know that the world is so bent on trying to take and harm and isolate our little ones from us. But we pray, Lord, that your protection will be upon them, that the enemy will not detour or discourage or hinder the growth, the spiritual and physical, mental, emotional growth of our little ones. We cover them in the blood, and we ask that you continue to protect them in all your ways and all their ways. We lift up Ukraine, and we know Pat is coming. Rabbi is going to introduce him. But, Father, we know that there are so many that are crying out for you over there. Our prayers, our faith joins their prayers, their faith, that they will be encouraged to continue until the victory is won. Any demonic force that would like to try to hinder Pat's message, we cancel it. We shut its mouth in the name and through the blood of Messiah, and we pray that you bring forth a strong message. Open our eyes, open our ears to hear and see what we're not seeing in the media. And we pray for salvation for you. If you need salvation, contact us. We will introduce you to your Messiah for all eternity. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Thank you, Mark. We had a very blessed event a couple of weeks ago, and this is what we always do after that event. The event was a tevilah in Hebrew, or an immersion in English, and we had five people immersed, three of which are here today, so I'd like to invite each of them to come up and get their certificate of immersion. First of all, Steve Kakuzi, and then... and Cindy Brody. Why don't you stay here, Steve? Stay here. I want to pray for you guys. Well, we got one of these for Stella, too. Okay, stay here because I just want to pray for you guys. And finally, for Ken Stahl. And... Olga and Jennifer Whaley also were immersed, but they're not here today, so we'll get them to you. So just stay there. Let's just pray for these and the other two. Father, we just thank you for these who have taken this step and come forward and in obedience to what you say in your word, and were immersed. And we thank you for them, and we pray that as they continue to seek to follow you, that this would be like... A giant step forward for all of them, that they would see a big difference in their faith, in their ability to hear you, and their ability to follow. So we just ask your blessing on them and on the other two in Yeshua's name. Amen. 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 So I just want to take a minute and introduce our guest speaker, Pat Labarbera. We met a long time ago. It's got to be 15 years ago. Pat was doing healthcare, health insurance, and we contacted him to be our broker. And he and I were just reminiscing about those days. Some of you remember Danita, who was in Elizabeth's role. She was our administrator. Danita and Pat would have these discussions about Messianic Judaism, whether it was really something that was of God or not, and about replacement theology, and they would go on forever with this. And eventually, Pat started coming to the Messianic Judaism class, and he was there for quite a while, and I finally concluded that in all that discussion and arguments, Danita actually won. So Pat has continued to serve us in a very important way. He's been our health insurance broker for all of these years, and I can't tell you what a blessing that is, because if you try to do health insurance for an organization, it's just mind-boggling all the choices you have and all of the details and all the things you gotta fill out and do. So he takes care of all of that like this. He's amazing at it. And that's part of what he does. The rest of what he does is that he has been a missionary to the Ukraine for many years. And so we've not been like supporting him regularly, but we've been supporting him by employing him through the health insurance brokerage that he does for us. But just when the war started, I found out that Pat was over there. And I was watching his Facebook feeds with videos of what he was doing over there, which he's going to share. And we just felt like we really need to get behind what he's doing. So we're going to turn things over to him, and he will share with you what's going on. And then we're going to take up an offering for the Ukraine after that. So I got to turn your, I got to turn you on, right? You are on. Try it out.
Hello. Test 1, 2, 3. All right. Hello. So, now this is going to sound a little funny. My name is Pasquale Giuseppe Cristoforo Labarbera. That's why Pat, it's so much easier for everybody else. But for you guys, my name is Pesach. My name is Passover. I was born on Passover. My parents named me Passover in Italian, which is only funny because in Russian, there isn't another word. So I am Passover, or they call me the Easter Bunny, white and fluffy. That's kind of how it worked out for me. There is one thing I always have to do before I start, so I make sure that I'm not offending anybody. Yes, kovot is this, который можем меня понять. No, давай, раз, два, три, четыре. Just the four of you, right? So, you know, я так и знал. Как это? All right, I knew. All right, if you guys open up your Bibles, the book of Hebrews. Is that appropriate to do in a synagogue? We can open, okay. The book of Hebrews. I'm just going to read a few verses, and then I'm going to kind of explain what's going on. I got to set my timer because I will go long, and I will try not to. I want to be respectful. Resume. All right. Hebrews chapter 13. I'm just going to read a couple of verses. I'm not really going to preach to you this morning as much as I'm going to show you what God was showing me when I was serving in Ukraine these last 2.5 months, okay? It says, let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves in the body. Marriage is honorable and all, and the bed is undefiled, and whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. Let your conversation be without covetousness, be content with such things as ye have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Right? Now, as we kind of said, this is my company. Hit the next slide for me, please. Who we are. Real simple. Next. This is my crew. At the list, one on the left, this is my daughter, Emily. The little one in the middle, that's actually my wife. She's sitting over there. Скажи привет. Thank you. Right? That's me. That's my son, Dima. The little one in the middle is the monster. Right? And there's one in the oven. Yeah? That's what I'm saying. So we are 50-50. My wife, hey, what happened? My wife, my daughter, and my son, the three eldest, if I can say it that way, they are Ukrainian, born, raised Ukraine. They've only been in America maybe 2 years their whole lives, right? Myself, the little one, and the one in the oven, American born, right? So we're a 50-50, if that makes sense. All right, hit the next one. All right, so his foundation versus his foundation ministries. What Rabbi said is true. I own a health insurance agency, right? I am a broker. We have, I don't know, it was just over 800 individuals, 600 retirees, 120 businesses, 4 states, da-da-da-da-da. Basically, I didn't want to go around from church to church and go, please, please, please give me money so I can be a missionary. I'm not built like that. And I have lived in Ukraine for 19 years, right? I mean, I know 19 years kind of sounds like a nice number. This is kind of respective. Anna, skolko tebe let? She's 16. She's Ukrainian. She just came here last year. And I've lived in Ukraine longer than she has. Right? Put that in a little bit of perspective. Those 19 years, I have never one time, not one time, taken one dime to be a missionary there. Didn't want it, don't like it, never want to do it again, right? But we'll get to that in a minute. The His Foundation Ministries, hit the next one. This is how it works. September to December, right, is open enrollment. That's when you guys get all those phone calls and you got to change this and what if I get what's my spouse's health insurance versus, I have to be here for that. No one cares if they have an address change or they have to add a dependent throughout the year. We just do it online. But when it's time to pick your plan for the next year, they want to see my face. So I'm here. Right? And a broker just means we represent them all. It's fine. Next slide. January to May, I'm in Ukraine. I'm a professor. I actually teach international economics Yeah, thanks. See, I like this guy, right? I teach international economics. It's really Dave Ramsey's financial piece that they called American capitalism, and we agreed on international economics, right? American capitalism, right? This is one of my classes. This is actually a high school, right? I also teach medicine. Strangely enough, when I became a Christian, I was in medical school. I was in my 10th year as an orthopedic surgeon. I was in my residency, and I had to make the decision. Finish and take your MCATs or go to seminary. So I tossed the MCATs and went to seminary. Right? Go back one more. Right? This is another class. Now, what we do, and you'll see this, we go to remote villages. Now, when I say village in Ukraine, and these guys will understand, right? When I say village in Ukraine, I mean carrying two buckets of water home on a dirt road village. Right? Now, there is places like Lviv and Kyiv and Odessa where there's McDonald's and KFC and paved roads and all that good stuff. Well, mostly paved roads. It is Ukraine. Right? Some of you know, right? But the villages, right, where these guys are, there is outside, there is the boys' hole in the ground, and there's the girls' hole in the ground, and that's the toilet for the school, right? So we go there, and I teach them. Now, what we do is when I go to the universities, I teach at a bunch of different universities, a bunch of different high schools, I go there to bring them home. So I'm the professor, which in this culture means I have a little bit of respect. They respect the teachers. I talk to them. They say, you have some knowledge, and then we bring them to our house, so we can have English club, business club, couples connection. My wife runs Young Moms, because I would be really bad at that. Bible studies. So my poor wife has 50 to 60 people coming through our house every week. That woman can bake. I'm just saying. You want to keep kids coming to your house? Feed them, right? Hit the next one. So this is them. They come to our house so we can bring them cookies and this and keep going. Hit the next one. And then we teach them being around. Now, if you can see, the gentleman to my right, is Indian. Strangely enough, there is a lot of Indian people from Ghana, people from Africa, from Japan, from China. They come to us to actually get cheaper education. They're my medical students, okay? And then we come in and we tell them about Jesus Christ, and they can go back home. It works out great. Next. And we do this to grow our church, so it looks like that, right? I have started 6 churches, right? I would make a horrible pastor. Me in the same place for 30 years with the same people, one of us would kill the other one. That's just not how I'm built, right? But you want to get something started, I'm your guy. So what I do now is I actually work with another pastor, another organization, and together we have just around 42 churches that we work with, right? So I'm the guy who goes into that village, sets himself on fire. Everybody's like, hey, come look at the American. He speaks Russian. They gather together. We tell them about Jesus Christ. I slide out of the way, and they start to teach them. Works out pretty good, right? Next, June to July, so the summer months, right? We do free medical clinics in remote Russian-speaking villages. Young camps, teen camps, English camps. Hit the next one. So this is a church. I learned a long time ago, somebody told me, what's the best missionary book in the Bible? I said the book of Acts. They said the book of Ruth. How's the book of Ruth? Well, Ruth was a Moabitess who had to come to Israel, and Naomi had to show her what's up with the culture and how to work things out. That is a much better idea. So what happens is, go back one slide for me. I work with this guy in the blue shirt's the pastor. So I will go to a pastor that I know that we work with, that we support, right? And then these people, there's 144 people at 8 o'clock in the morning that line up to come see the doctors. Some of my students and some Americans that I put together as a group to work together. So they have to come in. Next slide. And then they have to listen to me preach for 30 minutes. Anybody who listens to me preach for 30 minutes needs to see the doctor afterwards, right? So then after me, they have to go see the doctor. Next. Now, here's the fun part about these doctors. See the tallest guy in the back with the blonde hair that's kind of waving over? This is Dr. Vadim Guy, right? He is here in Henrietta. He runs Family Vision Center. The girl down to the left is Mariana, right? Up a little bit. You can see who she is, right? She's a nurse practitioner, works at Strong, right? And they were born in Ukraine, lived there till they were 5, 6 years old, came here, and now they're professionals who work here, and went back to serve the people in the villages where they were born. The only joke is, as Vadim, Mariana, and Valeri, right? They came back, and everybody's like, in Russian, there's no ah, there's no direct article. So it's like, your doctor, not a doctor, not the doctor. For us, that's a big difference. So they look at me like, you doctor? Yes, but not the doctor you're here to see. And they're like, let me get this straight. The American doctors that we're here to see are named Valeri, Mariana, and Vadim, and they speak English. Right. But you're the guy from America, and your name is Pasquale, and you speak Russian. Yeah. Okay, this is totally confused, but this is how it works, right? So we do this in remote, these guys are obstetricians, so once they go see the doctors, then they have to go see my daughter, right, and pick up their prescription glasses, or sometimes we've done this as dentists, sometimes we've done this as orthopedics. Orthopedics, that's my specialty, is more difficult because I can't bring an MRI machine or an X-ray machine with me. That's much more difficult, so we work on these, right? And we do that so when the people are standing in line and after they've had the unpleasure of listening to me speak for 30 minutes, the pastor can minister to them, grow them, and they know that they go to the church. They go to the place where the pastor speaks to get the help. That's my goal, to have them keep coming there, not to come see me. All right, next. Then we go to the camps, right? Easiest way to get guys involved, cook a steak, right? Right? In Ukraine, the steak's not very good, so we do shish kebabs. That's why they were talking about. Shish kebabs there is better. There, beef, not so much. The pork, I'm sorry, I know where I'm at. I'm just saying it's better meat, right? So we bring them together. Next, then we get them into our house. You can see again the girls down here in the front from China, the lady up there from India, like international people. Next, they can't come home. They can't go home during the summer, so come spend the summer with me. We'll talk about Jesus. This is young moms. There is a significant amount of single mothers in Ukraine. Because child support doesn't really work. It's easy for a guy to impregnate the woman and say, shh, I'm out, and she's on her own. So we bring them together. I spend a lot of time calling them Your Majesty. Like, what do you mean, Your Majesty? I'm like, well, if I understand correctly, if you're a Christian, your dad's a king, so that makes you a princess, right? So you're valued. Feel valued. And we try to make them feel valued and teach them about what's best to look for in a guy, what's the best, how to raise the child, what's going on. Next, right? Now, this is where everything changes. That's what I normally do. Now, hold there for a second. Come March, so that you know, we came back to America because my wife and my children needed to get American passports, and the law says they have to actually live in America to make that happen. You can't become American and not live here. Makes a little bit of sense, right? All right, so we came back here. They were going to make me domesticated. I actually had to buy a house for the first time in my life and settle roots. It's not really my strong suit. So we're here for about a year, right? We're getting that process going, and then the war starts. Have any of you guys heard of New Yorkers for Constitutional Freedoms? It's a Christian lobbyist group, so they're also my clients. I do their health insurance as well. And the guy who runs it, Jason, calls me up. He goes, hey, look, there's a lot of stuff going on in Ukraine right now. I'm having trouble finding it on the map, right? Would you come in and actually do an interview? Sure. So I come in, I do an interview with them. All right, turns out it got popular. We had like 1,000 views. I was like, I've never been on Facebook. I get like 15 likes. I mean, that's about the extent of it. All right, so we got that. After that, Calvary Chapel said, would you come do an interview for us on the radio? Sure. So I came to an interview for them. Right after that happened, the news called. Would you come do it? I'm like, I don't really know what's going on right now. Right, so I just kept telling people, this is what we do in Ukraine. I don't. This is how I see it. This is what I've seen in the years. Right. After that happened, that was like 3 days in a row. They just kind of showed up, did my interview. And after that, someone called me up and says, hey, we'd like to give you money for Ukraine. Can we do that? No. Well, why not? Because I've never done that before. I don't know how to do that. I mean, you're just going to give it to me. I'm going to put it in my bank account. I don't know how this is going to work. As God is my witness, in less than an hour, 10 people called. And I'm like, okay, I get it, boss. I get it. Yep, I understand. I'm listening. Right, so I made GoFundMe, Facebook, all of them, because I didn't know who's in. And if you've never done this before, you can't just like start it. It takes like a week or 2 weeks to research you to make sure this is legitimate. And I'm feeling bad that these people got to get some money, and I didn't know what I was going to do with it. So I called my pastor in Ukraine, right, Sasha. I call him up. He's like, yeah. I'm like, how's it going over there? He goes, we're doing okay. I'm like, what's going on in our town? Are we getting in trouble? Have you guys gotten bombed, gotten shot at? He goes, right now it's really calm where we're at. I'm like, okay, can I come help you? And he's like, I love it when you're here. We get a lot of stuff done together. He goes, but, and then he holds up the phone on FaceTime and scans around the room. He goes, there's 20 other guys standing here going, we don't know what to do either. I'm like, okay, could you guys use some money? Well, absolutely. I'm like, okay, how about if I send you the money? I'll just wire it over. He goes, yeah, but they're only letting us take out 2,000 hryvnia, $60 a day out of the ATM. That's not going to get us very far. I'm like, How about this? What if I get enough money, I fly over, right, and I'll just walk across the border, give you a hug, put some cash in your pocket, spend the night, and then go home? He goes, that'll work. I'm like, okay. So I know by law I can take $10,000 in my pocket, right, and not have to declare it. That's the rule at the border. It's like, okay. All right. I said, all right, Lord, $10,000, I will fly over, I'll pay for the ticket, get everything taken care of, give them some money so at least we can get this taken care of. In 3 days, we had $23,000. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, right? Yes, boss. I'll be obedient, boss. Right? And if I don't want to offend you if I call him boss, just because I like where it says that he was about his father's business. Right? I'm about my father's business. He's the boss. I just do what I'm told. Right? So I'm like, okay. Thinking a little bit like a Ukrainian, I think, what if I put $10,000 in one pocket, $10,000 in the other pocket? I only have to declare one pocket at a time, right? They'll never catch me. So I flew from Rochester to JFK, JFK to Paris, Paris to Bucharest, Bucharest to Suceava, right? My guys picked me up at the airport at 1 in the morning at Suceava, Romania, right here, right? They drove me to a house. They brought me upstairs. There was a mattress on the floor. I crashed, woke up the next morning, goes, where am I anyway? They're like, you're still in Romania. Okay. Whose house is this? They're like, we don't know. I'm confused. He goes, yeah, wait a little bit longer. And a lot of other people started to wake up. And there was like 40 people from my church at this one house. I'm like, okay, who's in charge? Right, we go downstairs for breakfast, right? And I meet the people that are in charge. But they don't speak Russian. They don't speak Ukrainian. They don't speak English. They don't speak Italian. I'm like, I'm running out of languages, people. Like, we got to be able to communicate somehow, right? Their daughter speaks English. I was like, so we waited a couple more hours for the daughter to show up. And I said, listen, what's going on here? Well, mom and dad are in their 70s, and they had 12 children. And the 12 children are all grown now, so we had the space, so we just took in the refugees. I was like, that's awesome. Can I help? And she goes, who are you? I'm like, right. I snuck into your house last night. No one knew. So I am one of the pastors at the church. I help out there, and you have a bunch of my church people. I hope that they're behaving themselves, right? Can I help you? And they're like, well, listen, the house is paid for. That's not a big deal, but we went from 270-year-olds to 40 Ukrainians, so the water bill, the electric bill, the toilet paper bill, like, everything went up, right? I'm like, okay, what's the average salary in Suceava, Romania? They're like, $550 a month. I'm like, okay, how about if I give you 3 months' salary so you can continue taking care of my people? She gave me a hug, said something in Romanian, and that was done, right? So now I jump in my car, and I'm headed to the border, right? But you need to understand, if you are a man in Ukraine between the ages of 18 and 60, you can't leave the country, right? Some of the guys got out before that rule happened, so they don't want to get anywhere near the border, right? So they drive me close to the border, right? And then I put my backpack on and walk in. Easiest time. Usually it takes 6 to 8 hours at the border. I think I made it in like 15 minutes, right? Because I'm the only idiot going the other direction. Everybody else is coming out, right? So I get to the other side. They pick me up in a car. We drive home. We give everybody a hug, see what's going on. These are my angels unaware. Right now, I know that they're children, so they're definitely not angels. All the fathers here will admit that they are not angels, right? But did you ever think about that? Like, this is Bible, right? So I want to say this is cute, that these are the angels that are unawares that I'm, but I can guarantee you it's that one person that's come in to spend the night that's irritating you to no end. That's the angel. God's going, do you have the patience? Are you going to be loving? Yes, boss. Right away, boss. Right? So these are my kids in the morning. Go to the next one, right? And I met these guys. These are some of the drivers, some of the pastors, some of the guys involved in church. Now, we got together when we're there. We get together in the morning, say, who's going where? Who's doing what? So we have some accountability, but not accountability like they're going to do something wrong. Accountability like so they came home, right? It's a war going on, right? The guy next to me with a hat, that's Sasha. He's the one that basically runs the 37 churches that are not my six. Yep, that's him. Next slide. These are where the people are staying. So what I want you to understand, if you could skip to that map for a second. Where's the map of Ukraine? Yes. All right, I'm going to try and do this. So this is how this works. I live here, right? Jana and Albert, they're up in here, right? Now, there have been bombs and missiles going off up there, but most of it's happening down here. Okay? So I'm going to put this into New York's perspective for you. Let's say that we live in Buffalo, New York, right? 45 minutes from Niagara Falls. I live about 45 minutes from Romania. Understand? Right? So I can be out of the country like that. However, the war is going down. We're going to say, for all intents and purposes, in New York City. Right? It's farther than New York City, but for our scale, New York City. So the war is going on in the Bronx, Brooklyn, and Queens. So what happens is I will stay in Chernivtsi. I will fill up my car full of supplies. I will drive down to New York City. I will sneak in through New Jersey, through Manhattan, right? Get into the boroughs as best I can, give them the supplies they need, fill my car full up of people, and we'll drive back up to Niagara Falls, right? Now, anybody who wants to stay in Niagara Falls can stay. Anybody who wants to go into Canada can go into Canada, right? This is basically how it's happened, to give you a spec. Now, obviously, from here to New York City is like 6 hours. From here to Odessa is more like 12, right? So it's a longer drive. And to throw in a little bit of caveat on that, there's something called Komandansky Chas, curfew, martial law. So we can start at 8 in the morning. We can finish at 9 o'clock at night. But you got to make that 13-hour drive. So no ifs, ands, or buts. You either make it or you got to find a place to stay for the night. Or sleep in your car. Not that I've ever done that, right? So this is kind of what's happening. Now, we used to be driving up into, we drove up into Kyiv, right? Now, if you've been watching the news, all the problems with Bucha and all that stuff, that's like right over here, right? So I live here. I drive up to Chmelnytsky, Vinnytsia, then you go up to Bela Tserkva, which is funny because that means white church, right? And then come around the other side and come in this side so we can actually get into the places, right? Now, this is where some of the other things happen. Hit the next slide, if you can go back to where we were. Yep, keep going. I know I put them out of order for you. Go back to where you saw the mattresses. There you go. So when I got there, this is what I saw. We have housed, all right, 1,200 people in our church, right? When I first got there, there was 500. Now there's more like 200, 225. Now understand, right, when the war first began, right, everybody was coming up to us because you can either get out into Poland, you can get out into Romania, you can get out into Hungary, but we are right there at the border. Now, if you were running away from the war and you didn't know because the war started in New York City, right, and you lived in Poughkeepsie, right, and you drove up here to go to Niagara Falls, after a while you figured out, they're not going to make it as far as Poughkeepsie, and you go home, right? People from Harrisburg drove up and said, oh, no, we can go back. So people came up right off the bat, didn't know what that was going to happen, and then some of them would be able to come home. But the war has actually grown into other cities that it wasn't in, and now they've come to us. We kind of have a rotating door. So we had, on average, about 500 people, and this is where they're sleeping. This is one of our church buildings, right? But a lot of them were on yoga mats. Anybody here volunteer to sleep on a yoga mat for 20 days, 30 days, a month, month and a half, two? So we had to take care of them. This is where, remember them that are in bonds as being bound with them. How would you feel, right? So we went out looking for mattresses. Couldn't find any mattresses because our whole city was like this. It's not like our church is doing this job. Everybody bombarded our city. So everybody came to the city. I got to love the Ukrainians. Everybody was coming to our city. So my apartment that used to cost me $250 a month is now $600 a month. Yeah, I know. They didn't really take care of their own. That's kind of how it works sometimes. Right? So they came up there. And now everybody's looking for mattresses. Everybody's buying this to make the people at their house comfortable. Right? So we went out to go find mattresses. Well, I couldn't find any. So we started praying for the mattresses, like, please, 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 right? And just as we were finishing the prayer, I'm not even kidding, I hadn't even said amen yet, and my phone rang, and you're like, the devil always has to bother you during your prayer. Well, nope, it was a guy named Igor that I won to Christ last year, and he goes, listen, are you back in Ukraine? Yes. He goes, we just had a tractor-trailer load of stuff come in from Romania. Do you need anything? You got any mattresses? He goes, 20. I'll be right there. So we go fill them with, it's like, I'm like... The whole time, God was like, I'm sorry that the war's going on in Ukraine, but I'm having the time of my life. God is just hitting these things all over the place. So this is where they're staying. Keep going. Yep, this is where they're staying. So you can get the idea of we actually, little things, like we bought a hot water heater. We bought a stove so we could have the people cook for themselves. I filled them up with food. This is the Ukrainian version of Costco. We call it Metro, right? I keep going to the next one. All right, this one's a little bit different. Now, from my perspective, remember, a lot of my students are doctors. 19 years, that means a lot of them have moved up in the hospital, the director of surgery, the director, you're like, these are my students, right? So I contacted some of them going, what's going on? What do you guys need? And they said, actually, we're not having a problem with trauma at the moment. We can't find the medication that the people need daily, like insulin. Like, yeah, if you don't get enough insulin, that's a problem, right? And insulin is not something you can just grab, buy, throw in the back of your car, and take off. Right? It has to be kept at a certain temperature. It has to be kept in glass bottles. So I drove into Europe. I bought that refrigerator there on the left. I hardwired it to my car. and I filled it as a doctor. I had my students write me a lot of prescriptions for insulin for people that don't exist so that we could fill up my refrigerator full of insulin, and I went around to all the hospitals giving the insulin out. Right? So we started giving out the insulin, closed it back down. While I was there, next slide, they told me this was a problem they were having. They're tourniquets. But I know we've watched a lot of movies where they take belts and they wrap the belt around. It works. It's not the greatest answer, but it works. What's supposed to happen is you're supposed to clamp it down tight, one-handed, because you just got shot, right? And then the Velcro picks a size, and then you twist something three times to crank it down so you lose your pulse, right? But nobody had any of these. So I asked the guys, I'm like, how are the soldiers dying off? Like, what's the problem? They're like, the wounds actually aren't that bad. But it's a two-hour drive from where they got shot to where the hospital is, and they're bleeding out. So I said, let's see if we can make a tourniquet. So we made a tourniquet, not a very good tourniquet, but a tourniquet that would work, right? Then after that, I ran into a dentist. He goes, I can do better than that. Like, you're a dentist. He goes, well, have you ever gotten your teeth 3D scanned? Yes. I got a 3D scanner. So we bought an original tourniquet that cost like $30. He scanned the plastic pieces and then printed them out of teeth material, right? I took him to the wedding dress maker in our town, right? He gave us all of the Velcro and elastic, and we made our own tourniquets, right? We made 4,000 of them, and we racked them in gospel tracts to say, God loves you, will save your life and your soul. And we gave them out to 4,000 soldiers, right? So this is what we got going on. Remembering them as being bound with them, right? Next slide. So this is, sorry. So the one on the left is my blue bus, right? And the blue bus is a fun story for me. I got there, I sold my car because we moved to America, so I have no way to get around. Only 40% of the Ukrainians actually drive. Not everybody has a car, right? There's mass transport you can get around. It's a lot easier. We have buses, right? But in order to get things done quickly and easily, I took the bus. So they took me on a bus, this bus, up to go to Kyiv because I wanted to see what was going on in the capital. How do I get around? What do I do at a checkpoint, right? How do these things work? Like, this is my Naomi. Like, I needed a Naomi to take me through Ukraine and say, is this going to work? And they were a little bit scared. They're like, you have an American passport. I don't know how that's going to go over. Well, let's give it a shot. So we drove up to Kyiv. We drove around where the problems were, and we got to our first checkpoint, and the guy hands out his Ukrainian passport, and he's like, what about this guy? So I hand him my American passport. He looks at it. He goes, hey, guys, come here. There's an American. So all these soldiers come over to our blue bus. Right, and they're looking in, they're like, you're an American. Yes. Who came here? Yes. You're a journalist? I'm like, no, worse than that. Pastor. They're like, pastor? And they reached through the car and hugged me, which is not normal, but it was awesome, right? So we started talking about, and they're like, let this guy through. So now my friend that's driving, he's like, you get to come with me everywhere we go, because that was easy. Right? So we got in the Kyiv and we solved these little problems. Right? And then we went back home, and now I figured out how to do this, so I would just wake up earlier than everybody else and take the keys to the van until they realized that I wasn't going to give the van back, and they're like, fine, you can keep the van, right? So I was driving around my van, filling it full of food, taking it to different places. Now, I learned a long time ago that I don't want to be the big shot. Like, I don't want to walk in and be like, I'm here, I can solve all of your problems, what do you need? That doesn't work very well. I want my God to get the glory, right, and I want them to come to the churches. So I would work with the local pastors. I would sneak in. Like, the people that you saw that were feeding, the reason why those pictures aren't very good, they have no idea that I'm the one paying for that. And I don't want them to know. I live there. I don't want to go back and they're like, oh, listen, my daughter got sick. Could you call America? Because we could, like, I don't want to be that guy. I'm there to tell them about Jesus Christ. I'm not a bank, right? So a lot of people don't know. I'm just the funny American. I'm not the guy who's funding all this stuff, right? So I'll take these food down to the pastor. The pastor will take care of his congregation to figure out who actually needs it and so on and so forth. Well, what happened to my blue bus is I had to come back here to kind of refit. So I flew back to America for about 7-8 days, refit, got some things that I know that we need in Ukraine that I couldn't get, said hello to my wife, set some things up, and went back. Well, while I was gone, one of the guys took my blue bus, and he drove down into one of the areas, and now the blue bus has got bullet holes in it, and it doesn't work anymore. So now I got the white Lexus. Now, that is how a missionary should travel. I'm just, no. Right? The reason is, first, try and buy a car while the war is going on. Like, that's a good, easy thing to do, right? Second, because I'm driving in some of the war zones, a lot of the rubble is there, there's a lot of off-roading, there's a lot of not-so-safe things, so I needed a four-wheel drive to get through. Second, it has two tanks. I have a gasoline tank, and I have a propane tank, right? And there's a huge problem. If you think $5 a gallon is a problem, we have $8 a gallon, and the average salary of Ukrainians, $400 a month. Yeah, figure that out real quick, right? It's like a $600 trip just for me to get from where I am down to where the war is happening, right? So this is it. I put my box on the top. I fill it full of stuff, and we're good to go. Next one. Yep, keep going. So the guy in the middle is the pastor of this church down in Mykolaiv. Mykolaiv is an area that is currently being bombed, okay? He's the pastor, and I went to give him the stuff. We handed everything out to all those people. Everything worked out the way it was supposed to go. I went, the next slide I'll show you. He got drafted, and he couldn't be there for Easter Sunday. So he calls me up, and he asked me to come preach Easter Sunday. So I preached Easter Sunday while we were getting bombed. Talk about an easy sermon. If you were to die today, do you know if you spend the rest of your life? There's bombs going off. Like, you can't mess that one up, right? So a young lady got saved on Easter Sunday. That was a blessing, right? And then afterwards, we had fellowship, just like a normal Easter Sunday. But the conversation is not like a Passover. It's not like a normal, like you guys have the Seder, right? Like, it's not normal. They're like, well, what were you doing last night when the bomb went off? I was eating chocolate. What were you doing? I was hiding under the bed. I was in the tub. Like, this is our Easter Sunday conversation about what's going on. But we go back. Now, this same church led me to Sveta. That's a young lady on the left-hand side. Sveta is not a Christian. She lives a block from the church. She has a nice little cat that she didn't want to leave. We're not going to talk about how much grandmothers love their cats and won't leave when their buildings are getting blown up. So she went and hid it in the basement of the church. She's been hiding there for a month. But because of the cat, she can't take the cat on the bus. She can't take it on the train, right? And she doesn't want to leave the cat because she loves the cat. That's what she's so on and so forth, right? So she told her sister, I'm waiting for someone to come pick me up like a taxi. Her sister goes, you're an idiot. No one's going to come pick up a Ukrainian grandmother, right, and take them out of the war zone. I preached on Easter Sunday and said, hey, anybody want to come with me on the way back home? Right? So she jumped in my car and she goes, listen, I'm not a Christian. I don't believe in God, but I prayed the other night that someone would come take me out of here and you showed up. So 13 hours, we talk about Jesus Christ. Okay? Next slide. So this is the fun part. After Easter service, while she was packing her stuff, I went to go to the hospital to check on some of my guys. My guy here is the director of surgery. Big shot. All right, so I go to check on him. We come in, and he goes, listen, they call me Pascal, right? They're like, listen, Pascal, do you remember when I took your class in college? Yes. Do you remember what grade I got? I'm like, no, I've done this 19 years. I don't remember all the grades. He goes, I got a C. In medical English? Yeah. Here's the problem. We've got umpteen boxes of medical support from America and from Europe, all in English. Will you go sit down with the nurses and help us translate all that? Sure. So a couple of hours, I'm like, I never thought in my life I'd have to translate colostomy bag into Russian, right? So, like, we put this bag, and who sends a colostomy bag to, anyway, right? So these are where the needles go. Oh, thank you, sir, very much. These are where the needles go. This is where the IV bags go, because they still have IV bags and glass. We have them in plastic bottles, so now you have to explain the drip and the whatever. So I spent a couple hours doing that for them. As I was doing it, the hotel across the street got split in half. I jumped out of my skin. I've never been bombed before. Like, that was my first experience with hearing what that sounds like, right? He starts laughing at me. I'm like, well, what's so funny? He goes, Doc, listen, if you heard it, it's too late. Just keep working. Right? So now down to our verse that I will not fear what man does unto me, right? Okay. So we just kept working. It just became this thing. Next. This is from the place that I was staying. I'm not a very intelligent man. So I heard these bombs go off, and I saw them, took the picture out of my window, and decided to see how far away is it. So I just drove in my car. It was 2.3 minutes from where I am to where that is. Right? That's a little bit changing of your feelings, right? Next. Probably a video will start, but just, yeah. These are my guys. If you hit that, will a video start or no? No? Hit the next one? All right. So it didn't really show it. I'll get to that. So when I got there, one of the guys makes windows. That's one of the guys at the church. He makes windows for a living. So we were using, because he's not selling windows at the moment, right? So we were using his warehouse as a place to store all of our stuff. And it wasn't working out very well. So we bought this tent, we bought the shelves, and we made, this is our squad? Our inventory, thank you. Our inventory where we keep stuff. Now, we are very blessed that because we are a church, we are a nonprofit organization in Ukraine, that we can receive humanitarian help from all the countries bringing it in. We just have to organize it and hand it out. So we didn't have to buy all of it. Some of it we did, some of it we didn't, right? And this is what our looks like. Hit the next one. Okay, so go back one. So what we did is we would get all of the bigger sizes and then we would put them into individual bags. So we have given out about 863 individual bags of food for people in our town, right? So this is what you have to understand. There are the occupied areas, which is where I go, where the shooting goes, right? There are the people that have come to us that need to be fed because they're not working and they don't have any money, right? And then there are the doctors that I go see. Right? Then there's the refugees that are actually across the border. So there's lots of different, and there's pastors and churches. Like some of the pastors, you just have to give help. One guy had over 378,000 miles on his minivan because he kept just driving people out, right? And it broke. So we got him another minivan for another $6,000 so he can keep going. Another guy was doing fine, but he couldn't afford the gasoline. So we just bring him tanks of gasoline so he can keep driving people in and out, right? It has gotten now where we can't get into the war zones. Like Kherson is an area where I used to go to. Right, that was another fun, quick story. I got to the border to give the guy the stuff, and he calls up, and he goes, Pascal. And then I hear, bop, 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 bop. I'm going to be late. You can be late. It's okay. Slow down. Like, you don't drive through the bullets. Right. Well, now I can't get into Kherson. So somebody who lives there and is written there, in Ukraine, you get written into your place. This is where you're written. Right. So they can go back. So we actually... They've come to us, they've sat with us for a month, they're bored out of their minds. We're like, look, here's the keys, here's some gas, here's some food, take it home and feed the people in your area. Right? So they go home, they get that, they come back out. In our area, and this is a wonderful story, no, go back, wonderful story for me because I'm not very bright at this. In Mykolaiv, they've turned off the water for about 2 months now. Right? Now, they are on water so they can go get like the river water, the seawater, right? But you're not going to drink that, right? And it's kind of hard to take a shower out of it. Right, so on and so forth. So I just kept filling up with water. Well, as God would have it, because this is how our God does things, one of the bombs hit next to the church that I was preaching at Easter Sunday, and it rocked the ground so bad that a fountain started to come up. Okay. So I talked to the guys. I'm like, listen, guys, can we get a well put in there? He goes, we don't have the money for that. I'm like, yeah, how much does a well cost? He's like, but maybe $1,000. You get the guy that dig the well, I'll get the $1,000. All right, so we got the well dug. I come back up to where we live in Chernivtsi, back in the safe area, right? And a couple of Americans came in, and because I'm not sarcastic at all, I started talking to them in Russian, had the Ukrainians translate for me. Just because I'm that guy, right? And because of my sarcasm, I missed out on those were the water filter people. So praise God, they found out that of me being the jokester, and a company from Colorado had brought in water filters, right, that they were giving away to churches to help create the living water. So we grabbed the filter, brought it down, and now this church gives water out to their whole neighborhood. They have to come to church to get the water, right? Like, see, God does this stuff, right? All right. This is my car for all the guys that are interested. This is my Lexus. I'm filling it with gasoline on the top, filling it with propane at the bottom, all at the same time. You gotta love it. If I get shot, we're gonna explode, but this is fine. And they're selling my Lexus today. Then we needed some more money in order to buy a bus that could fit more people. We have a Sprinter van that's like the Ukrainian pickup, so we're selling my Lexus to get a Sprinter van so we can carry more stuff. Next. This is called moral support, right? Yeah, see, we get the men's ministry guy. We understand this. If you have been eating rice and drinking soup for a month and a half, and someone says, how'd you like to have steak on a stick? Volunteers? Anyone? Anyone? Yeah, right? So this is what we got. So we decided to have this. Now, I will say this. There is a fifth grade class at Lima Christian School that collected bottles and sent us $140. So we fed 25 Ukrainians for $100. Next. And these are the guys that have been doing my packing for me. Next. This. Again, back to the medication. I thought if it works in the hospitals, wouldn't it work in the church? So I had the pastor take a list of all of the medications that all of the people, usually, don't be offended, please, the grandmothers that didn't want to leave, right? Because they just have to stay home. They can't be transported. So all the grandmothers are staying at church. I'm like, you give me a list of all their medications, we'll buy them all, right? So we went to an apteka, pharmacy. See, I'm just going to keep looking at you for those translations. We go to the pharmacy, and I had them just fill my list. Then I went to the next pharmacy until the whole list would be filled. And then we drove. This is $250 worth of medications that will take care of every grandma in the church for a month. Why would you not do that, right? So we come down. Next. This is a story more for me than for you guys. So if you remember my blue van, right? So there is a, am I running short on? I'm doing okay. All right, so there is a gentleman who was teaching at the university in our city, Chernivtsi. He's deaf, right? He can sign in English, Russian, and Ukrainian. So really smart fingers, right? Like, I'm not pulling that off. I can sing church songs. That's like as far as I get, right? So he was working there. He lives in Texas. I don't know if we can consider him American if he lives in Texas, but nonetheless, like he lives in Texas, right? That's like I said when I came into church today. I don't know what was the bigger miracle, you guys getting this building or getting from someone from the south to move up to Rochester. I don't know, right? This is how that worked. So the guy in Texas, he wants to come over and help the deaf people because the deaf people can't hear the air raid sounds go off. Like, they're sleeping with their doors open. Someone's staying awake all night long waiting for the other Ukrainians to go down to the basement. They're going, like, oh, we should probably go because it sounds like something's coming. So he wants to help the deaf, right? So he was connected with this one group here at Browncroft Community Church. Someone at Browncroft Community saw me on the news. They're like, well, listen, if you're going to Ukraine, you could probably help our guy, right? So, okay, so I start talking to these people that run this missionary group called Deaf Bridge. Right? So I start talking to them, and they're like, well, how do you do this, and how do you do this, and how do you do this? And I was explaining, they're like, well, how about if we get you on, like, a Zoom call where someone will translate for our guy? We get on the call, and he's like, wait, you're Pascal. I'm like, yes. He goes, they said you were Pat. I'm like, well, in America, I'm Pat. He goes, I know you. My daughter used to come to your youth group. Right? This is how these things were. From Texas. Right? He was like, so how did you figure out how to do this? How did you figure out how to do this? And I explained everything. He goes, listen, let's get together in the whole group so you can help us make a plan on how we can help the deaf people. So we get on the phone, and I'm not kidding. Their budget is like $180,000. Remember, I had my $23,000. The deaf people are richer than us, I guess. I don't understand. But on the phone with us trying to make this logistical thing happen is the Green Beret. I'm like, wait, no. Like, the legitimate, like, you're still serving in the military Green Beret? Yes. And I'm a Christian. Like, I didn't even know they made those Christian Green Berets, right? So this is great. So I explained to them how we're doing, and I told them the whole story, the things I've been telling you, and they're laughing at me the same way you guys are. And he goes, listen, can you do us a favor? Sure, I'll help out as long as he goes, we have a special forces medic in Lviv. Will you go up and we will train you how to do trauma? I'm like, can I get a certificate? Because I just want to put something on my wall that says I was special forces trained. Right? So they gave me a bunch of these little booths, right? So airways bleeding. So we packed these in all of our buses, right, that are traveling around all of Ukraine. So in case someone comes across someone, we can take care of them. I love how God did. Special forces trained. Anyway, sorry. Go to the next one. Simple things like helping the soldiers that have been sitting in block posts. Checkpoints, thank you. They've been staying in the checkpoints for a month, month and a half, not being able to go home, wearing the same underwear, same pair of socks. Right? They just wanted to shave and brush their teeth. I will take care of our soldiers, right? Support the guys who are supporting you. Next. Right? These are the guys that are packing our gospel tracts in with the tourniquets. Next. Next slide. Maybe. Okay. It's a video, so it won't really show, and I'll get to the end of it. This is how I kind of left things. Like, I could go on for hours and tell you the stories. Like I said, God just kept doing this thing after this thing after this thing after this thing. Like the refrigerator and hot wiring, it should have cost me right around $3,000. Just so happened that two Ukrainians worked at the factory in Prague where I bought it, and they gave me their discount, so it cost me $1,200. Like, things like this just kept happening over and over. As long as I would get out and do something, right, God would take care of it, kind of like what you guys were saying earlier. I'm telling you, with the whole gasoline thing, this is what this was going to show you, right? You have to wait an hour and a half to get 4 gallons. You spend an entire day just getting a full tank of gas. So I'm telling you, I feel like every time I want to leave Chernivtsi, right, to go to Mykolaiv or to Kherson or to Kharkiv or to wherever it is I was going, the war zone, I felt like I was Peter taking that first step out of the boat going, Lord, am I going to make this? And he's like, you just keep stepping out and I'll keep filling your tank. Okay. Maybe this would be specific for you guys. I made it down to Odessa. Odessa has been getting bombed, but it's not horrible at this particular point. And I was there, and one of my friends, Vadim, he owns 18 bread stores there, right? He goes, listen, you want to go hang out with me tonight? I'm like, well, sure, I don't have to go any place till tomorrow, right? So we went out and hung out. And that's a perfect picture for this. There is the man in Odessa that runs all of the security cameras in the entire region of Odessa. That'd be like the biggest security company in New York City, right? He happens to be Jewish, right? And he invited us over to end Shabbat, right? So we could have fish and so on and so forth. So I'm sitting at their house, right? Remembering everything that I learned between my seminary class with Danita. That's no joke. Listen, I have two bachelor's degrees from two different seminaries and a master's in theology, and I think I learned more from sitting with Anita for a couple of months, debating back and forth. Like, that was legit, right? So now I'm sitting in front of the biggest shot we have in Odessa for security, and he's Jewish going, please let me remember everything she taught me. Please let me remember everything, right? So we start debating back and forth, and we're having this great time. And I remember Rabbi Jim saying, don't use the scriptures. Use the calendar. If you're going to witness to a Jewish person, use the calendar. So we're going through all those things, and we're talking about Yeshua. And then he found out about the tourniquets. He's like, wait, I run a security company. Can we get some of those tourniquets? I'm like, here. And I gave him 50 tourniquets. He goes, here. And he gives me this black card. I don't know what that means. Like, a black card is kind of an ominous thing, right? He goes, you show up at any of my gas stations at midnight, they'll just fill your tank. Right? I was like, I love my God. So, how have I left it? My wife, the amazing woman over there, before I left to go to Ukraine, right, I said, sweetheart, are you going to be okay if I go there? I promise, as my daughter says, I promise not to do anything dumb. Crazy, that's a different story. Dumb, I promise I won't do. Right? Are you going to be all right if I go there and I do this? And my wife looks at me. She quoted somebody else, but she remembers the quote. She goes, I would rather be married or widowed to a martyr than married to a coward. Right? That's my timer. So, love my wife. She's that woman. 2.5 months later, she calls me up. You need to come home. I'm like, what happened? We're having child number 4. Like, I'm on my way home. Right? So, I've come home to take care of her. But these guys, you've seen pictures of me because I was there. Right? With me. You can see, I'm not going to say, hey, listen, let's grab the church guys. Let's grab the bus and let's go get shot at. Like, I'll risk my life. I'm not risking theirs. But there are 6 guys that are still doing what it is I was doing without me, right? They're still going every couple of days, taking that 13-hour trip out, 13-hour trip back. We're trying to find ways to get people into this area, get people out of this area, get people into that area, help out the doctors. Right now, I'm trying to get a couple of thousand. You guys know what quick clot is? Okay, yeah, see, it's medical, right? If they get a bullet hole, anybody see Saving Private Ryan? Right, that white powder they throw on there? They put that powder in gauze. So you take the hole, you jam it in the hole, and it clogs the artery so the guys don't bleed out. Then you put a chest seal over the top of it. Or even if it's not in your chest, you still use the same thing. They have none. They're still using the sulfur powder from like World War II. I'm like, no. Right? So I'm trying to buy as much of this quick clot as I can, the chest seals as I can, and we're going to ship that over, right, and have my guys divvy it up and take it out to the hospital so we can help the people that are coming and that are bleeding out. Right? So just went, as I said in the beginning, 19 years I lived there, I've never taken support to do anything that I'm going to do. I don't want to be that guy. I just want to help Ukraine to get through these things, and I will go back again. So if God leads it on your heart, by all means. If not, I know our Father has enough to take care of what it is I need of. Don't worry about it, okay? Thank you very, very, very much for your time. Thanks, Rabbi.
Well, thank you, Pat Pasquale. Thank you for giving us a new perspective on what's going there. And for me, just be thankful for what's going on here, because things could be a lot worse. So, as promised, we're going to receive an offering for Pat's work in the Ukraine. Not for him, but for the work, right? And you can give through an envelope, just write Ukraine on there. If you didn't come prepared to give today, you didn't bring your checkbook, that's fine. You can go to Giving Fire, shemaisrael.givingfire.com, and just put in the notice there, Ukraine. You can put we have a bunch of funds, but you can put a note on when you give through the online site, and just put Ukraine in there. So I believe this is a great way to reconnect, because it's just been so disturbing to me that you can't even find stories about what's happening in that war anymore. It's like the news cycle has passed, so it's on the back page of the newspaper, or it's not even on the website anymore. Just, and people are suffering tremendously. Children, people are still trying to get out. It's just incredible. The bombing is still going on. So let's pray. So Father, thank you for what we heard and saw today. We thank you for where we are, but we also are challenged by the scripture that Pat started out with, that we need to help those who are in need. And so we pray, Father, for you to just move upon all who are watching online, all who are here, to how much we can help with what's going on over there. We've been helping in other ways through Jana and Albert's collection and sending over. And also, everybody should be aware that we support three ministries regularly out of our tithe on the tithe that we give here. Reach International with Stuart and Chantel, Jezreel International, which ships things from Albany, and the Joseph Project, which brings aid into Ukraine from Israel. So we're doing that, but Father, we just pray that you would multiply what we can do. And we pray, Father, for Pat, I want you to come on up here. We just need to pray for protection for you, I believe. So, Lord, we just thank you for our brother and for the courage that you have placed in him. And we pray for your guidance and your direction. I know there's going to be more miracles. We pray for protection from the dangers that are there. There's a danger just in driving your car through an intersection, but this is driving your car through a war zone. So we pray for supernatural protection for him. We pray for your blessing on Katerina and the baby. And we just pray, Father, for this, what we can give to be effective. And we thank you. And also, you have T-shirts out there, right? What's the deal on those?
The boss. What's the deal on the T-shirts?
Donate. Okay, probably we can give a donation out there for a T-shirt also. They're designed by Katerina, and they're all about Ukraine, right? Okay, so Father, again, we thank you, and we just trust you. We pray, Lord, for an end to this catastrophe. We pray for a turnaround. We pray for there to be a victory for the Ukrainian people. We pray for protection for them. We pray for our leaders here in America, for them to be able to help and to bring this chapter to a successful end. Not meaning that the whole country of Ukraine is destroyed, but that the destruction would stop and there would be a rebuilding and a restoring in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. So we're going to have the worship team share a song. We just pray, Father, for the offering right now, that you would multiply it and bless every person who is hearing this, whether giving or not. We pray for your provision for them in Yeshua's name. Amen.
All right, we are going to bring our service to a close. One quick note about if you want any groceries in the kitchen, just give Naoka a few minutes because she's also teaching the kids today, and there are a couple things she needs to pull out of the fridge that maybe would have gotten too warm if she had pulled them out earlier. So just walk slowly in the direction of the kitchen if you're planning on going there. But walk quicker if you've got kids that you need to pick up. With that, would you please? And also, if you would like prayer for anything, the prayer team and elders will be available for that as well. Please join with me in the Vnei Emar. Vnei Emar, Vahaya Adonai, Lamelech Olko Haaretz, Bayom Hahu, Bayom Hahu, Yie Adonai Echad. Ushmo, ushmo, ushmo echad. And it is said, and the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day shall the Lord be one, and his name one. Amen. And now please receive this blessing and bless those around you with it.
Yivarechech Adonai ve'yishmerecha Ya'er Adonai panav eilecha v'chuneka Yisa Adonai panav eilecha ve'asem Shalom.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and place his peace within you. In the name of Yeshua our Messiah. Amen.
Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom.